Good afternoon, South Africa, and welcome to Afternoon Express. It's a brand new week, and I hope you had an incredible weekend. My name is Danilo Aquisto.
I'm Bonang Matebo. We're live right here on SABC3. Thank you so much for joining us. It's a brand new week. It is a motivational Monday, and boy, what a show do we have for you. For the next hour, just sit back and relax.
Indeed, we've got a host of celebrities in the building with us today, and they're all here to talk about one thing, living your life on purpose. We're joined by an author by the name of Petra Laranjo, and she wrote this incredible book called Living on Purpose. It's a really cool guide to how to live out your life in a way that is meaningful and that impacts others too. She basically went around the world and interviewed 50 of the most influential people and shared a bit of their story. So more of that later on in the show.
Yep, one of those influential people being Hollywood actor Ray Stevenson. He is in The Loft, better known for his roles in Thor and in Dexter. We're going to be chatting to him to hear about his story and how he is living on purpose alongside with Petra Laranjo. Very excited. Plus, don't go anywhere because you stand a chance to win a copy of Living on Purpose. But we'll give you the details on that a little bit later.
We're joined by Bonnie and Mbuli today with our other guests, though.
Good afternoon, South Africa. Welcome. Great to have you with us. And joining me in the kitchen are two South Africans who've been really impacted by the principles in Petra's book, Chris Jaftha and Tanya van Graan. Welcome to The Loft.
Thank you so much. It's good
awesome.
To be here.
Lovely to have you.
Thank you.
And they'll be chatting to us a little bit later about what it actually means to live on purpose. But I'm not alone in this beautiful kitchen of ours. It's everybody's favorite chef and food stylist, Claire Winstanley.
Hello.
How are you doing, darling?
I'm fantastic today.
Awesome. So today we're cooking with black garlic.
I know. Do you know what that
I've
is?
I've never heard of it.
Ooh, I'm going to tell you later. So we're doing black garlic two ways. So two exciting different things to do with it. And so many more. There's so many cool things.
Anything that involves you is exciting. And do remember, we are live. So you can call in and chat to our guests on 083-913-3728 or just tweet us at Afternoon Chat, hashtag Afternoon Express, or comment on our Facebook page. Right now, though, let's join Danilo on the couch with our first guest.
Yes, that's right. Now, the opportunity to star as a superhero in a Marvel blockbuster is something most young boys can only dream of. Joining us in The Loft is a man who has not only earned it that opportunity once, but has done it twice as the Punisher as well as Falstag in the Thor series. Joining us on the couch is Northern Ireland-born actor, currently in South Africa filming the series Black Sails, Ray Stevenson. Very warm welcome to our loft.
Good to see you, Dan. Thanks for inviting me.
It's an absolute pleasure. Now, Ray, first of all, I think the biggest thing that we have to ask you is you've been the Punisher, you've been involved in the Punisher, in Dexter series, in Rome is one I wanted to mention. So Rome is a big one. You've got probably the biggest body count out of all actors in film and television ever.
Well, yeah, it kind of feels like that sometimes. I think, actually, on the Punisher, my stunt guy and myself, who I got very close with, a great friend of mine, we decided to try and keep a tally, you know, almost like an old fighter plane on the side, on the side of the trailer. We started to put a tally up, a body count. I think 3 weeks in, we were at 82 and we just had to stop.
It's exhausting.
So how many today?
Why so many villain roles? Why so many killers?
Well, I mean, you know, he was a, if you're talking about that, the Punisher in particular, he's a violent man who operates in a violent world. And he does violent things to violent people.
That's exactly what it's about. And I think the one thing that I love about your new character in Black Sails is that he is a slight divergent from what you've done before in terms of his past, his history, and sort of what motivates him moving forward. But Blackbeard's a progression throughout this whole series.
Well, he's mentioned, and sure enough, you know, this sort of fan base were driving, so when is he going to come up, and da-da-da, and sure enough, I got the offer and what have you, and I looked at it, and there's not a lot of material you can look at because they're pretty much working on them constantly as they're going along. But I watched the making of, and that's actually, I would recommend that to anybody to watch because you see the production values, what's gone in to make this thing work. And you talk about South Africa, quality of the filmmaking process, and the crews here are world class. They're first class. Thanks. So you're watching the costume designers, and you're watching the set builders, the manufacturers, the weapons people. It's a monumental piece of work. It's a huge investment by Stars, which is paid back buckets load by the quality of the crews down here, and indeed the everybody who works on the show. Sure.
So obviously you've not new to South Africa. You've travelled quite a lot, and your partner's an anthropologist. Yes. She's very involved in.
She is.
This must excite you, like travel, experience,
I mean,
food, culture.
She turned around to me at one point and she said, "You know, this is lovely," because normally she would be bouncing around the world before I met her, and like spending a week here or 2 weeks there. And I, And she said, now, finally, I get to be somewhere for like 2 months or 3 months or potentially longer. And she can drop in with our kids now for like a month or 6 weeks and actually get to live somewhere. She, it's amazing. A huge difference.
Yeah.
And actually experience a place to a much deeper level.
So you made quite a lot of this decision to move into the film and television industry quite later on in your life. It's only been about 10 years you've been
film,
in this industry.
TV, theatre, it's the whole thing. I mean, basically...
Why so late?
Well, because I grew up in the northeast of England, Newcastle upon Tyne. And let's just say that the priorities in life were not necessarily pursuing an artistic career. It was, you know, we were busy, you know, not being big about it, but, you know, it's a humble growing up, and it was living week to week, basically. We weren't going to theatre or whatever, didn't have access to it. So to consciously try and commit to a lifestyle that you have no contact with, you've never met anybody who actually... lives that life, it's too far removed. It's like other people, that happens to other people, but there's something burning and you don't know what it is. And I got to a point I thought it was an alter ego. And if I kept feeding the alter ego, it would quiet down. It's like, you feed the beast, it'll just quiet down. but it didn't. And I mean, at first I went to an art college and ended up being an interior designer, an interior spatial designer in an architectural practice. And I was working in London and I was renting a room in a house with these beautiful people. And going to work every day, but I got to the age of like 25 and I was going to theatre on my own, getting £10 tickets down at the back, and I saw this, I saw stuff that was just kept moving me. And anyway, cut a long story short, a mutual friend turned up from Australia, an actor looking for representation in London, and he's the first person I ever blurted it out. I mean, it took one or two, three bottles of wine, but I blurted out because he's the only person who could actually understand what on earth is this thing inside. And he said, you know, you've got some serious questions to answer. So, you know, go for an evening school, a bona fide evening school, which is run by a bona fide theatre school, which the tutors involved in all this, you know, they'll be able to realise the seriousness of this is a life-changing sort of thing, potentially, and give you that proper answers that you're looking for. So I got into this evening school 2 nights a week, and within 2 weeks, I was terrified because I knew I was just...
In over your head.
It was, I had no choice in this. It was, you know, we think we can make decisions in our lives. And sometimes, you know, I mean, I'm now being 51, it's like I realize that the decisions we make is what socks we wear. The big decisions, right, you know, I don't know, should I stay with him? Darling, you've already left. Right? You've already left. Just like accept that you've left and just get on with it. That's not a decision. And this sort of heeding that is just like you've got to try. Wherever that leads, will determine what your life ends up, but you've got to listen to yourself and get yourself moving.
And the sort of defining moment for you where you realised you actually had a talent, that it wasn't just something that you thought you would have enjoyed doing?
Well, you know, that's the hardest question to ask oneself, because you don't want to lie to yourself. You quickly realise that there is no career ladder here. There's no rhyme nor reason in this sense. It's just there are a lot of amazing talent out there who... People say, don't get the breaks, or whatever is it
play. Whatever barriers in the way.
Yeah, you know, it's just like, so you learn to be very humble, and very so aware of the privilege of working and maintaining that work and keeping a career. And in fact, what defines you as an actor and defines your career is not necessarily the roles you take. It's actually the ones you turn down. Right? We'll all do the great jobs and that, but the ones that you listen to, you keep listening to yourself. And being honest with yourself enough to go like, you know, I haven't worked for a couple of months, but
I need
that
work,
one's
but
just, but
not
that one's,
it.
That one's not it. And you know, you do go feast, famine, feast, famine. But if you can make a living at this job, then you're a successful actor.
Absolutely. Obviously, now into your fourth season of Black Sails, there's a lot going on in your life. But future plans?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think Marvel have been talking about Thor 3, because they do them in trilogies, you know.
I was hoping you would have said that.
So I get to don the fat suit again, which is yay. Yeah, they do clean it with vodka, but that's gone. It's all gone by the next day. I've got like three of these neoprene fat suits. I have to wear a vest underneath, which has these tiny tubes where I connect up to a bucket of ice water, literally
just
pumping around the core to bring, because I don't think I've got all the fat suit, then the costume, then the armor, then they put a big mohair beard on me, almost,
and then the lights,
and a wig, and they say, here's an axe, and then the armor, you know, go fight, and you go like, you're standing still. And you're getting, yes. Well, why are you red in the face? It's just, I'm cooking.
Makeup.
Yeah, I'm collapsing. So between takes, it's like I'm plugging in these two tubes. And it's glamorous.
So you are going to be heading back into
Well, I think so. I mean, if they do call for it, yeah. I mean, I think that's the plan. But I can't be too sure on the dates. So I've had a movie out just this year, Big Game, with Sam Jackson. I've got another one coming out, Transporter, just about to open with Ed Skrein, not Jason Statham. It's a reboot. Luc Besson producing. So that's again another. I play a real sort of hammy old spy. I'm playing his dad, and I get away with murder sometimes.
Incredible. I really do. You do literally. That's the whole thing. That's your whole job, is to get away with murder.
Well, yeah, justifiable homicide, some could say. But no, I mean, it's, you know, it is what it is. And you know, you hinted at it before, actually, Danny. You said about how cool is it, you know, to be the mob. You know what? I harbored a little personal, selfish dream about having an action figure. I've got three now.
Really?
I mean, it cracks me up. But if you ever get big-headed about it, you know, do you want to see my action figure?
Yes,
go, where's my head?
Yeah.
And I've got three young boys, 7, 4, and 1, who go, oh, bah, bah.
Break it off.
I've got one of my action figures got a Lego head on it.
Yes, oh, God.
Well, there's a leveler. Yeah. You know what I mean?
You children just don't get
exactly what it's meant to be for. So, yeah. But, it, you know, those sort of dreams, and you do... You do pinch yourself at times when you realize that you not only achieved your dream, but that old cliche that I get to live it.
Sure. And we're here to celebrate that today. So thank you so much for joining us in the loft and on the couch. And I know we want to speak about the book that you're
involved with. Yes, we do, about Petra's book.
It's incredible. And I love the fact that you're sharing a bit of that journey about living a life of purpose and of meaning. So we really appreciate you being with us, Ray.
Thank you so much
for joining us. Ray will be back on the couch with us a little bit later on discussing Living on Purpose with author Petra Laranjo. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Fresh Pack. Goodness comes naturally.
You're back with SABC 3 here on Afternoon Express. We're about to start cooking, but just a quick question. Do you generally just take your jewelry off when you are cooking?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, so you would have taken off your very new piece of jewelry.
Yes.
Congratulations, indeed. You got engaged. Sorry, guys, she's taken. You finally put a ring on it.
Actually, we were having that conversation. I was like, I can't cook with jewelry on. It just feels weird.
Is it heavy? Is it a heavy rock?
It's sure.
Yeah.
No, I'm a simple girl. Simple things.
Awesome. Okay, so.
Okay, back to other diamonds in my life. And that's black garlic. It really is
black
the
garlic.
Diamond of garlic, or the gold of garlic. It's so delicious and rich. The secret to it is that it's deeply caramelized garlic.
Deeply.
Quite
until
simply.
It was black.
It's slowly cooked at low temperatures for a long period of time. I'm not sure of the exact time length, but long periods of time, and it caramelizes it into this like intensely rich flavor. It's sort of the only way to sort of liken it is like a sweet balsamic vinegar. It's quite simply.
Yeah.
Garlic licorice.
And do you buy it already like this, or do
you
kind of blacken it yourself?
Woolies has this package for you, and you can spread it on toast. Or what we're going to do today is make a fantastic black garlic vinaigrette.
Wow.
So we've got some of the black garlic, which you've just lightly sort of roughly chopped up here, and we're going to pop that into a bowl. It's not, you know, it's not at all like normal garlic to work with, so you've got to kind of get used to it. It's very much like, it's got that soft dried fruit texture to it.
Oh,
it's a little
nice,
bit chewy and soft.
Okay.
So what I like to do is just chop it up first a little bit, and then just smush it. Technical term, that one. into your bowl, just to kind of break it up a little bit.
And what kind of dishes would it be ideal for?
Oh, very rich, you know, sort of so steak. So we're going to make a black garlic butter as well. Pop that onto there. Like I said, you can spread it on toast. Use it like you would balsamic vinegar almost, like in those sort of dishes.
Okay.
Great in a pasta as well. If you just have...
A sauce. I guess it would be great in a sauce as well.
Literally just sort of chopped up into a pasta. Mm. Delicious.
Wonderful.
So, you know, just simple ways. It really is such a fantastic flavor. You don't have to mess around with it too much.
Yeah.
So like I said, we're just kind of... smushing this into the bowl, like I said, very technical term there, but I'm sure everyone knows what I mean. Salt and black pepper, just to season that up. And then we've got over here some white balsamic vinegar.
Okay.
Really just to complement that balsamic taste. You can add whatever vinegar you want, but I just thought it would be fantastic.
Right.
So you can pour that. Yeah, go for all of it. And we're just going to whisk that up slightly. And then while I whisk, you can add some of our olive oil.
Olive oil.
So for me, vinaigrette's typically one part vinegar to three parts oil.
Olive oil.
And just whisk that up. And just
that should
some
be
extra,
fine, huh?
Yeah. Okay. Some extra flavor. We're going to add some chives into that.
Yeah.
That complements our potatoes so well. So ultimately, this vinaigrette is going onto potatoes, which is
yummy.
Spectacular.
That is, sounds so yummy. Yeah.
So if you want to pass the potatoes over here, cool. We're just going to toss that together.
Okay. And don't forget to pop over to our website, afternoonexpress.co.za, for the full recipe and shopping list.
So that goes in there, and we're just going to toss that up. And then this, so we've just boiled these potatoes, nothing special, just boiled them. Uh-huh. Then they're going to go into the oven at 180 to 200 degrees, and this vinaigrette's really going to sort of caramelize and darken and brown and really roast
and
these potatoes
crisp,
up.
Yeah.
And then we'll just pop that out into a roasting tray. And that's going to go into the oven. You can sort of reserve a little bit back of the vinaigrette and sort of spoon it on later.
And it's best to make sure all the potatoes are covered, right?
Exactly. So I'm just going to keep sort of moving these around and coating these. And these are going to go into the oven at, like I say, 200 degrees, 180 to 200 degrees until they're nice and golden and roasted.
Oh, awesome. So these are about to go into the oven.
Yes.
Okay. Bonang is standing by on the couch.
Thank you so much, Bon Basil. Now, my very first guest today, right here in the loft. She was born in Nelspruit. She spent her formative years growing up on a farm, but she also had her eyes set on becoming a star. After moving to the city of Johannesburg to study drama, her career in acting and modeling flourished. And in 2007, she was named South Africa's sexiest woman. Joining us on the couch is the beautiful Tanya van Graan. Lovely to see you.
Thank you so much for having me.
I don't remember... When I saw you actually outside of the loft, I'm like, I'm trying to remember the last time I saw her, and I think it was a few days before your wedding, and it's almost 2 years since your marriage. How has that been?
It's been amazing. It's been 2 years. Time does fly, and it's incredible. Not a lot changes, I think, when you pick the right partner, and a partner that compliments your life.
Yeah.
It's incredible. It can only go, you know, up from here.
And talking about your life, I mean, a lot of people don't know that you grew up on a farm.
Yes.
And, you know, I always want to know how you got from farming, I mean, growing up on a farm, to become this amazing model that flourished and was the sexiest woman in 2007. Do you remember the journey?
Yes. And I think it's because I grew up on a farm, I was able and privileged enough to dream big dreams that wasn't influenced by media or by, you know, other people around you. And I think that's the thing, because a lot of times we watch TV or we're in cities where we're amongst people that have certain jobs and we want to become it for the wrong reasons. And for me, it was more, I always wanted to be a performer, but more so I wanted to have a terrain of influence. And I knew that one day that would offer me that kind of thing. So I had a lot of time of dreaming, living on a farm. So yeah, that was amazing.
I mean, today's Motivational Monday, Tanya, and I think, you know, the reason why we brought you here is because of that book, Living on Purpose.
Yes.
When did you discover the book? Do you remember? And, you know, what impact has it had on your life, on your career, on you as a human being?
I've known Petra for many years. And when I heard she was doing a book like this, it resonated with me a lot, and because I've always lived by this,
really?
Living on purpose. So it's not a new thing for me. It's something I like to say all the time, living on purpose. But for me, it really is about what I just said before, having a terrain, being able to use what you have to have an influence, whatever it is.
Mm.
I always thought that, you know, the more you have, the more success you have, the bigger the terrain, the more influence. And lately, I've realized it's not always the case at all, because people say, I want to wait till I have that kind of platform, and I realize whatever you have is enough to change something. And that's what living on purpose is about. It's about using what you have, not just for yourself, but for somebody else. And that will motivate you to go through times when you don't feel like working hard, but if you know it's for a cause and for somebody else other than you, that's what gets you going.
That's beautiful. Do you have a mantra? I know, you know, most successful people who live on purpose, you know, have steps and goals and dreams and mantras that they live by. Is there a specific, you know, saying or quote that resonates in your mind every day that keeps you going?
Funny enough, living on purpose was my mantra way before any of, you know, of the book or anything like that. That way I was so happy when I heard about it. But humility, for one, and generosity. And that's what true legacy means, if you want to leave a legacy. Because people, like, I never wanted to be a star. I just wanted to live a purpose-driven life. I wanted to use the talents that I was given for whatever my destiny was. And that's the thing, very important, don't just pick your destiny. You know, you have your talents for a certain reason to have certain influence. And yeah, that's what it's about for me. It's about just using what I have to serve other people.
And I mean, your destiny and purpose is obviously something that all of us as human beings want to find here on Earth.
Yes.
How did you find your purpose? How did you know that modeling was what you needed to do, or, you know, you wanted to become a star? And what is it that whoever's watching at home should listen to, or the signs, and how do they know?
Look, I never wanted to become, funny enough, a model. I always wanted to be an actress, but it's hand in hand. And the great thing is, the first thing that you can look for is your talent.
Yeah.
And a lot of times people say, I don't know what my purpose is. But then I say, do something on purpose. That's the difference, because you shouldn't wait till you know exactly what it is. Okay. So if you find something that you can do, whatever it might be, and you can do something on purpose to help somebody, or it enriches your life, because we're always in the looking for pursuit of happiness.
Yes.
And that is not true happiness, because happiness will go away, because happiness is about self.
Mm.
Happiness, having stuff, having things. And true, you know, joy is about living on purpose and giving, because that's true joy. It's not happiness, and that's what I'm about.
That's beautiful. I mean, you know, we haven't seen much of you. You know, there's so much I want to take away from you.
That's on purpose as well. For me, there's a time, you're saying, you know, people want to also do certain things. I never wanted to be a star for, that's why you won't see me a lot of times. I'm purposely don't like to talk or to share too much unless it has a purpose. And because I don't, personally, I'm not somebody who likes to show you what I've done unless it can inspire you. I don't like it to make you feel any less, but if it has a good purpose, then I'm happy to motivate other people to do the same, and to say, but I didn't have it easy either. You can do this as well. And I think that's
incredible.
We live in a world of self, so I think less self is good.
That is so powerful. Wow. If you have any questions for Tanya, obviously you can tweet us. We are live right here on SABC3. Use our official hashtag Afternoon Express, and you can follow us at Afternoon Chat. Call us as well. A little bit later, we're going to be chatting to Petra, one of the awesome authors of that fantastic book that Tanya is talking about. And remember, you can win a copy of that book, but we'll give you the details a little bit later. Another competition, Babon Bizzle has the details.
Thank you so much, Bea. Do you dream of walking along an island beach, soft sand under your feet, dipping your toes into crystal clear water and lapping up the sand? Well, Afternoon Express and Skull are thrilled to reveal our hashtag footsie competition, where a selfie of your feet could win a 7-night vacation for two to Reunion Island. But before you kick your shoes off and get snapping, are your feet summer ready? No? Well, stay tuned, because for the next month, we're going to be sharing daily footsie tips to get your feet picture perfect for the vacation winning footsie. Thanks to the Shoal Velvet Smooth electronic foot file, you don't need to waste a cent on expensive salon treatments. It's easy to use at home, so your feet can be pampered regularly with professional results. Here's how you enter to win that luxurious island vacation. First, make sure your feet are ready for their moment in the spotlight with the Shoal Velvet Smooth electronic foot file. Then snap a footsie, that's a selfie of your feet looking velvet smooth, and enter via Twitter or Facebook using the hashtag footsie, hashtag Afternoon Express. Winning that island holiday of your dreams couldn't be easier. T's and C's apply, so please visit the Afternoon Express website for details. Take a look.
From wild nature to clear blue lagoons, Reunion Island offers the traveler a unique adventure, exploring a diversity of landscapes and cultures in one exceptional environment. Classified as a World Heritage Site, Reunion Island's stunning landscape allows you to travel from a volcanic desert into a tropical forest all in one day. Enjoying the harmony of the island, you can experience a variety of cultures and tastes, from Asian cuisine to Creole markets. Reunion is paradise found.
Shoal Velvet Smooth electronic foot file. Perfectly smooth skin after one use.
Welcome back. You're watching Afternoon Express. We're live right here on SABC3. My next guest is a true testament to tenacity. Without any formal dance or drama training, he has secured a place among the greats of theatre and television, with roles in some of South Africa's biggest stage productions and TV dramas, with credits including African Footprint, Mamma Mia, High Rollers, Isidingo, and more recently, The West Side Story. Joining us on the couch is Chris Jaftha. Last time I saw you, we were frolicking on the islands of Zanz.
We were, darling.
Nice to see you.
Very good to
You're
see
still
you.
So handsome.
Likewise. Well, not
likewise.
Handsome. The other version of handsome.
Oh, thank you, darling.
Beautiful, gorgeous.
Thank you, darling. You've always been so good to me. But you know, what I find interesting about you is that, you know, celebrities, right? They use their profiles to do charity work. But you did it the other way around. You studied, finished studying, and got straight into charity work.
That's correct. I actually wanted to do some, well, a gap year. And that turned into plus minus 3 years where we raised money for HIV and AIDS orphanages back in South Africa. Traveling throughout Africa, Europe, and America. I really don't like necessarily talking about charitable stuff because I believe that should be done behind the scenes.
Got you.
But if you have to talk about it, if it's going to benefit the cause, then I will. So that's that.
So why did you then decide to come back into show business? Because you were there, you know, doing philanthropy work, CSI projects and all of that. So what drew you back into this glamorous world?
Well, I actually studied fine art at school.
Ah.
And it was weird. Okay, while doing the voluntary work, the charitable stuff, we basically did a little bit of industrial theater, dance, drama, where we taught about the history of South Africa, HIV and
yeah.
AIDS. And during that time, I mean, I never thought I'd be an actor. I always had a bit of a comedic bone in me, but I never thought that I would be an actor or a dancer or a model or whatever. And what happened was, I think it was my second year in the States, someone said, or a couple of people were saying, you know what, you should actually try this out. But it wasn't them that convinced me or motivated me to get into show business.
Yeah.
I just felt like that is where my heart was. There was a click, there was something that happened, and I just knew that that was where my purpose was.
Amazing.
And I know that over the years and over the course of this time,
yeah.
that the reason for me being in this industry, I believe that media and entertainment is a huge platform to be able to inspire and do good. And that's what I want to do, and that's the reason why I'm here, what I'm doing.
Yeah. We recently had Jonathan. Let's talk about the West Side Story in studio. How was that experience for you?
Oh, man, it was beautiful. Yeah. West Side Story. It was a real fantastic production. It was really tough because we started from scratch. We had the storyline and all of that kind of thing,
yeah.
but the direction was different. New choreography. We had a stunt choreographer in there who taught us some fight sequences and stunts.
Amazing.
Things that we're not usually or normally used to.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, there it is. Whoop. There it is.
Whoop. So there stuff it is. That we're not there you are. Oh my gosh, look at you. Okay.
That we're not used to. And it gave the show an edge. There was a realism to it that even people from overseas were saying that this was
yeah.
a show that they haven't seen before of the same production.
Incredible.
So it was a great success. We were proud to have been a
yeah.
big part of the success.
Living on purpose, like Tanya, you also discovered that book. Do you remember the moment you picked it up, and what impact has it had on you and your life?
Well, I heard Tanya saying that she's been friends with Petra for a long time. I think we're probably friends as long.
Oh, wow.
And I know Tanya about as long as I do know Petra.
Yeah.
And I think the reason why she wanted us to be a part of this was because she knows the values that we stand by. She knows the principles that we live by.
Wow.
And so it's a huge honor to have been a part of it and for us to have been a part of the campaign, Just One Thing. It's about walking out the door, doing just one thing. And it's not something that you have to think about. It's just about being the best of who you can be, sowing
Amazing.
Those positive seeds. You never know when you're going to be impacting someone's life with a smile. Or with just a word.
Yeah.
Imagine you being a negative person and you just go out and you're having a bad day and whatever the case may be. You can't, I mean, like for me, I can't live my life that way. That's why
yeah.
people say I'm always smiling and that kind of thing and I'm bubbly or whatnot.
It's awesome.
It's not something that's put on. It's just the way I live life and the process that I've gone through.
Okay.
And I know that that is the way that you're able to make a difference without you even knowing it.
Absolutely. You're making your debut on Top Billing on Thursday.
Oh, don't say that. Oh, no, I get it.
Tell me how the experience was. And what did you do? What can we expect from you from the best of the... Well, welcome, by the way.
Thank you.
Oh, how was
gracious. It? It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's never as easy as it looks, but
yeah.
I've been in the industry a long time now, and I know that you need to work hard. You know, one of my first jobs that I did was with African Footprint, and the lady told me, she was like, you know what, Chris, you can be so talented,
yeah,
but
if you don't put in the work, if you don't work hard, it means nothing.
All right.
So 10% talent, 90% hard work. So with top billing and my first insert at the Durban Fashion
Fair. That's awesome.
It was really cool. I worked with a really lovely team. Uh-huh. It was so much fun. It was a lot of hard work. All we had right. to run up and down. Apparently, it was as hectic as it can get.
Yeah. All right.
But we did a couple of other inserts after that and profiles. Okay. So I'm
going to put you on the spot. We're going to go to Bonnie in the kitchen. I want you to link and see what, how good you are in terms of your top billing delivery. Take it away. Take it away. Which camera is in? There.
Oh.
Yes.
Well, Bonnie's in the kitchen now, and she's about to hook you up with some flavor, some food. Bonnie, do your thing, girl.
Well done, Chris. You are so ready. Okay. Another thing that's ready is our potatoes.
Oh, no. How good do they look?
They look amazing.
Delicious.
They smell insane. Mm. I can't wait to eat them.
Like I was telling you about that flavor, the whole room sort of that balsamic.
Yeah. It's permeated the entire loft.
Yeah. No, it's delicious. So
okay.
The next part of our black garlic endeavors mm-hmm. is a black garlic butter. So we've got room temperature butter, so nice okay. and soft so we can whiz it up. Uh-huh. And our black garlic over here, which we've just popped some of the cloves out here. You can see how cool and like soft and
they are so perfectly
spongy
black.
Thumbs are. Yeah, they're stunning. So, you know, depending on the amount of butter you have, you know, 2 to 3 cloves, mm-hmm. it's mm-hmm. not, you really have to think about this not as that pungent garlic flavor. So don't be scared of adding a lot that, like, you know, normal garlic, okay. you'd be like, whoa, okay. hang on.
Right.
That's gonna
so
sit on your breath.
It's a tempered flavor.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. a very mild, mm-hmm. sweet, beautiful, mm. delicious softness in terms of the garlic.
Yeah.
You know, if someone gave it to you and you didn't taste it, you hadn't tasted it before, you actually wouldn't have a clue it was garlic.
Well, what's really exciting about this is that you don't have to chop it. I mean, as much as I love garlic, I just hate chopping it into those tiny little pieces.
Okay, so black okay. garlic, salted butter, because uh-huh. we're going to use it as butter, so okay. you want a little bit of saltiness to it.
You want
it
quite coarse
yeah.
as well.
Okay. And then some rosemary, just because mm-hmm. it's just a fabulous flavor that complements that garlic. Mm-hmm. And we're just going to whiz that up in with our stick blender just to create a brown butter roll. So it's going to emulsify with the rest of our butter. You can see how stunning that looks already. Just give that a good whiz. So the butter's going to mix up, the garlic's going to mix up. And you actually don't have to. So later we'll scrape that all out so we don't waste
okay.
any. But you really don't actually have to get
overblended. Yeah.
So what happens now is that you sort of mix it up and it almost gets a bit marbled.
Mm.
And you can see the chunks of the black garlic and it looks stunning. And then what
yes.
you do, pop it into some cling wrap,
okay.
roll it up, and you get a nice buttery roll like this. And you can keep this
is
in the freezer
it?
Or the
wow.
fridge, and you just slice off pieces of it as you will, so as you want to. So now
wow.
we've got some steak that we've sizzled up this, and it's all delicious and warm.
I can see what you mean by marbled.
Yeah,
look, yeah, it's got all these different
all the
colors.
Different butter, and you can see the little speckles of the black garlic. Fantastic. And
looks
this
gorgeous.
Literally goes onto our steak, and
okay.
slowly but surely in the warm steak, that's gonna melt and just get fantastic.
Wow.
So we'll
wow.
get that going there, and you'll see that later get all nice and melty and oozy.
Wow.
And
I love a good steak.
That really can go on anything. Like I said, you can pop that into some pasta, steak, beautiful piece of chicken,
yeah, yeah.
onto the potatoes. It's such a versatile beauty.
I can't wait to taste it.
Thank you so much, Claire.
After the break, we're back on the couch with Ray and Petra Laranjo joins us to chat about her book, Living on Purpose. Also, make sure you enter our Go Green SMS competition. All the details for this week's question are available on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. You have until midnight tonight to enter, so get SMSing. We'll be right back, so don't go away.
The Afternoon Express team is going green. Join us every Tuesday at 4 p.m. until September as we bring you the most innovative trends in sustainable fashion, food, decor and design, as well as handy tips to help you reduce your carbon footprint.
Answer our Go Green question every Tuesday and stand a chance to win a 1,000 Rand Woolies gift card every week.
Plus, simply by entering, you also go into the big draw for the ultimate grand prize worth over R500,000.
Including a dream sustainable kitchen makeover from Cordev, fitted with Bosch appliances with R300,000. Also, up to R250,000 worth of home upgrades so you can live off the grid. Plus, food and homeware from Woolworths valued at R75,000. And a R25,000 towards a school of your choice with MySchool.
So, go big. Go green with Afternoon Express every Tuesday at 4 p.m. to win these amazing prizes. Express
yourself. Willis and I collaborating to raise 100 million rand through the My School program. Are you with us?
Express yourself.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, through her book, Living on Purpose, The Key to Change Your Life and Impact Others, and the hashtag Just One Thing viral campaign, speaker and actress Petra Laranjo is changing lives across the globe. British and Hollywood actor Ray Stevenson was so inspired, he even wrote the foreword to the book. We're back on the couch now with Ray as well as Petra, chatting more about this book and the campaign itself. So Petra, very well, welcome to the loft.
Thank you, Danila.
So let's first begin about what inspired you to write this book.
So I've been writing for a whole lot of years, contributing to magazines. So it's something I've always wanted to do. And it just got to a point where last year I made a decision that it was going to be a year for growth and for impact. And I think just chatting with all the people I was working with, I've worked as an image specialist for corporates for so many years, which has been really fulfilling and rewarding, but there was just something else. And, you know, having a look and chatting with people that were working aimlessly and not having the lives that they wanted, and it just started speaking to me to kind of shake people up and say, okay, come, you need to wake up. And they're meeting amazing people and they're living their lives.
What do you think was the moment where you decided, I actually know how to live a purpose-driven life?
I think I've always had a bit of that inclination anyway to do things intentionally, but it's just started increasing to every decision that I make has to be conscious. There has to be a reason behind it. I don't just want to waste time and throw it away. You know, I need to honor why I'm here. So I think for so many people it will be different things. So for some people, they like the safety perhaps of, you know, a stable job. For other people, you know, we don't. We don't do that. So I think it's so individual for so many different people. So whatever it means to them, whether it's something that they grew up with that was inspired by their family or perhaps they came out of a circumstance that was so life-threatening and that's what made them change and that's what made them reconsider their lives. I think, you know, through all the stories in the book, everyone's got such an individual take on what living on purpose
means
to them.
Which is what I love most about it. You've taken 50 of the most influential people in the world and you've shared their story. Let's give a bit of a highlight of some of who those people were and what were those stories that I think are going to inspire the globe, which already has.
Wow, you're asking me to pick.
It's hard, because now they're going to phone you out and they're going to be like, you didn't mention my name, why not?
Well, Ray, for one, which was so much fun. I mean, we, as an actress as well, and my husband, who actually introduced us, you know, that was an absolute highlight for someone that's doing what we love doing and doing it on such a big scale. So,
well, it was a leap in the dark. I had never done something like this before, but it's just,
and you're so great.
Well, it was her title. At first glance, you think, oh, you know, yeah, of course, I get it. But you realize, no, I get living for a purpose, I get living with a purpose, but living on purpose. And I'll just start writing and just I have it. Sorry, I'm late. I know, and
I was,
and she was so patient. And then she said, no, it's great. Is it? Because I have no idea. But it was just made me question. And I think it's if anything, it will reach out to people and say, just think about that, living on purpose. And it starts to have a profound effect. And it's not like, don't go out and reach and look for a purpose. Live on purpose. It's kind of live without fear. I think so much of the problems what we experience nowadays is preconditioned schooling, preconditioned cultural influences, prejudices that are impacted and stamped on our very souls from such an early age. That's not our purpose. That's not living on purpose, to follow that through.
So what is living on purpose then, Petra?
So living on purpose to me, really, and this is my personal thing, obviously everyone's got their own, but for me it's living a life of intent. It's making sure that you're living a life of significance, that you're leaving some kind of legacy. But obviously to do that, you've got to make a decision to do it. So it can't just be, you know, living the 9 to 5 and maybe having a holiday at the end of the year that everyone lives for, or living the same year and repeating it 70 times. You know, it's making sure that what you're doing, the life you're living, is something that is fulfilling.
You mentioned quite a lot about it having an impact also on others too. I think that was one of the biggest parts. Why is that such a crucial element if it's such an introspective thing of living on purpose? How does it affect other people? Why is the other so important?
For me, you have to, it's a natural thing that I grew up with, and where you've got to be bringing other people along with you. Or else really, what's the point? Then it just becomes about ego and that's where it stops. So for me,
you do impact people naturally.
Yeah.
So you impact them with the negative sides, which is the norm in a way, bring them around to your point of view or your political point of view. That's not living on purpose. But if you start to live on purpose, you you kind of automatically, by osmosis, impact people around you.
Yeah. True. You know? And I think that's where sparked your campaign, just one thing. Let's talk more about that and the reason behind it. And
so I came across the stat where if you do just one thing every day, it doesn't matter how small, in just 40 years, you would have impacted the lives of 14,610 beings, whether it's human, animal, or the planet. Mm. So that's a call to action to say to people, again, you come across people that want to help, but either they don't have the time, they don't have the finances, they don't know what they can offer. And what this campaign is to urge people to, again, live consciously and do just one thing. Mm. So if every person on this planet is doing one thing consciously every day, so whether it's, you know, recycling, whether it's making an effort to listen to someone and taking the time to pay attention to someone else and to consider them, or something that we do, my husband and myself, is that we believe in sterilizing pets. Mm. You know, on average, 10,000 pets are put down and euthanized every single day. So if you can just start by sterilizing and adopting, you know, that's one thing that we're saving thousands of lives just by that action.
Beautiful.
So it's something that's doable. It's something that's practical.
You mentioned doing it for 40 years and you can impact 14,000 people. What is your word of advice to keep people encouraged about going through this process? Because it can be very hard. The world gets very busy. Things start to happen. How do you continuously remind yourself daily to live a life on purpose?
So I think that's really that's the call to action, and that's the click where, again, it's something simple. Mm. So it's making that commitment ahead of time.
Yeah.
So let's say, okay, I don't know what to do, but I'll buy a bag of oranges and it's in my car. So without even having to think further, because I've done that, I was out shopping anyway to buy groceries, so I might as well throw in an extra tin of food.
Mm.
And at the end of the month, if I can do that, because it's something I'm doing anyway, I'm shopping anyway.
Sure.
So it's making it fit in with your lifestyle and not necessarily having to go above and beyond, which so many people have, and it's amazing in the campaign. It's already impacted so many lives.
Sure.
But it's the small things that we're noticing the real big impact. So it's those small things that are coming back to me now, and people that I know are saying, oh, I did this and I did that, and that's really cool.
Yeah. So Ray, have you taken this challenge on?
Well, you know, it's strange. I think it's this thing about you realize that you were actually doing the challenge inversely, automatically, because of the things I was talking about before, because of the other things that impacted your life. Mm. You were actually having a negative impact.
Mm.
And I think just by making these first steps and just making this, you know, taking the challenge or whatever, making these first steps, it becomes natural, becomes habitual, becomes part of your nature. And if you think about it, 7 billion people on the planet, maybe 1 billion are adults and conscious and able and have the wherewithal to do that. 40 years, you got impacted 14 billion.
Sure.
Not 40,000, 14 billion. So you think, well, that's twice the world's population. You've affected everyone twice.
Mm, sure. Yeah.
And then who's to say how that's going to impact you when other people are doing the same to you?
True.
You know, it's not a one-way street here. It's becomes a two-way traffic, and it's like becomes a much more resource-based society where human beings actually like human beings.
Exactly. Mm. And I think what's fascinating about it is that you can be a world-famous actor like yourself, or you can be somebody on the street
kid, I'm dad. It's just like, you know, it's just like, I changed diapers. It's just like, you know, it's what I do, and I love to do it. And I say the privilege I got, I've been blessed with, is I get to do, to go to work what I love to do. And there's no guarantee I can do it for the next 6 months or the next year. But nobody can take away what I've done, how that's achieved, how that's impacted my life.
Sure. You don't let your work define you. It's about your impact that you leave behind that starts to
define you. Where that's going to lead. And it's exciting where it's going to lead. It's not. But we're always told that it's frightening. Like, we're told it's frightening going to other countries. Watch out for them. They're different. They eat feet of birds and stuff like that. But why is that not, like, thrilling? You know, why can that not be embraced?
How can we embrace the change and the difference?
Yeah.
And the thing that excites me the most is that you speak about it on such a deep level, and you're such a humble guy, and you're so excited about changing the world, yet you kill people for a living on movies and series.
That's entertainment.
Just saying. It is entertainment. Guys, thank you so much for being with us in the loft today. It is an absolute honor to have both of you. Thank you for trying to change the world in some very, very small way, but in a massive way at the same time. I really appreciate your time here today. Now, if you're inspired by Petra's story and would like to get your hands on her book, then now is your chance. We're giving away 2 copies of Living on Purpose to 2 lucky viewers today on Afternoon Express. Now, simply SMS the keyword Express, your name and city to 33728 to be entered into the draw. We'll be right back after this. Express yourself.
Any occasion, any time. Nobody makes better tea than you and Five Roses.
very warm welcome back. Now, legendary Belgian songstress Dana Winner is on tour in South Africa. We're giving away a VIP experience to two lucky Afternoon Express viewers. The prize includes a set of double tickets to the Cape Town or Johannesburg show, a signed album copy, and a meet and greet. All you have to do is SMS the keyword music, your name and city to 33728. And remember, SMSs cost R1.50, and you can find all the T's and C's on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. Now, that prize is absolutely amazing, but something else smells incredible on our tables. This dish looks insane, Bonnie and Claire. And first of all, congratulations on your engagement. I think it's such an incredible experience.
She's wearing it now. Go, Claire.
Claire, how is your wedding? Must I get a dress ready? Must I cook?
Are you a feeder in this relationship? Because clearly, one of those, right?
Got to start somewhere. Hey, this is how I got one.
He's a really clever man to scoop you up.
Yes.
Yeah. Congratulations. Absolutely amazing. But to our guests, right, Chris and Tanya, you were watching that interview, right, with Petra and Ray. Did any of it resonate with you, what they said in terms of the book and, you know, what it meant to them?
Mm. Absolutely.
Yeah, most definitely. The reason why, like I said earlier, we spoke about it as well. Yeah. We've got similar views in that, is because you don't have to wait for something good to happen. You can always be a part of something good. Mm. You just people are always waiting for something or wanting to be inspired and wanting to be motivated. Mm. But you can't rely on inspiration and motivation. You need to cultivate discipline. That's how you're gonna stay motivated.
Yeah. Or people think that it takes a while. Like there'll be a point in my life when I can inspire people, but first I must fill and first I must feed myself.
We judge our success, you know, we judge everything that we do, and we're in a society where it's all about social media and everything. So everything is being seen constantly and being judged.
Mm.
And we are even scrutinized. Yeah. We even scrutinize our giving. Mm. Or if we do something, it's too small, it's not enough, and that kind of thing. Where it's like, stop thinking, it's not even about you. It's just about going out and actually just doing it.
Absolutely. And you know, the thing is, that I've seen it kind of happening with social media, is that the value of hard work and patience and perseverance is withered away. And no one sees, you know, that you have to take, you know, an overnight success does take 4 to 5 years. Be patient. Mm. Yeah. Have a purpose. Mm. Find what it is you want to do, you know. Find something that you love, something unique about you that you could bottle and sell. Mm. Yeah.
And usually great opportunities find you when you're already moving.
Absolutely. Yes.
They don't come and find you still waiting for them to fall into your hands.
And that's good luck, you know, kind of being prepared and then God meeting you halfway somewhere in there. So I learned so much from the both of you, especially you, Tanya. You said some really profound things today.
Awesome.
So thank you so much
for
coming.
Not just a pretty face.
Speaking about social media, and Tanya, you've started an account for your cat.
Well, I've always had an account for my cat. I'm very passionate about animals, but
What's her handle?
Well, I've got two cats, and I just adopted another cat from a Persian rescue.
Look at them! Oh my goodness!
That's the adopted one.
I also just adopted a doggy. So
I think it's adopt, don't shop. Know your breeds. You know, the thing is also with animals. Animals are so, you can't just adopt an animal because it's beautiful. It has to suit your life, and they have to. You have to suit their lives. And I think it's about being humble enough to say it's not about me. It's about what am I doing? You know, the animal has a life, and I think that's awesome that you adopted. Yeah. And
kudos to you. Well, Chris, congratulations. Welcome to the Top Billing family.
Thank you very much.
I must say, good luck. Top Billing viewers are tough, bro.
That's all good.
Good luck, right?
Tough crowd.
Very tough crowd. Very tough, tough crowd. But welcome to the family, Claire. Thank you. I'm getting my dress ready, girl.
I'll get the invitations ready.
Absolutely, but don't forget to join us tomorrow afternoon, same time, same place, right here on Afternoon Express, as we celebrate International Literacy Day with two of South Africa's top authors, Lauren Bukes and Angela Mukwela. We'll also be giving away some of their novels, so make sure you tune in. That's going to be exciting.
Yeah.
That's your stuff.
Yeah, that's my stuff. I love books.
Any final words of encouragement for viewers out there in terms of living their lives on purpose, particularly as somebody who feels like maybe my life doesn't have much value to add, I'm not ready to live a life of purpose? What are those final words?
I say, you know, be aware of your terrain, because that's where you're going to have influence. Mm. Mm. Always
your friends,
listen.
Your family.
Everybody, the guy you walk past at the gate, you know, listen, because there's always a need. And if you can meet it, do it.
And there's always a story there that you don't want to ignore.
Absolutely. And you think that you're blessing them, they're going to bless you.
Bless you much more. Fantastic. Love it, Tanya.
Never despise humble beginnings. You know what? If everything is instant nowadays. Mm. And
the process that you go through over the course of time,
yeah,
that's your foundation.
Yeah.
If you don't get your foundation built, when the storms and the winds come.
I'm gonna have to cut you because we're running out of time. But if you want more of Chris speaking this Thursday, 7:30 on SABC3, a very new member to the Top Billing family. Thank you for watching from all of us here at Afternoon Express, back again at 4 p.m. live on SABC3. Good afternoon.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Tomorrow on Afternoon Express, we celebrate International Literacy Day with South African authors Lauren Bierkes and Angela Makolwa. And we speak with a representative of the Shine Literacy Program.
Another feel-good production.